Welcome back to Winning Law. I'm attorney David Nguyen with offices in Houston, Texas. So today we're going to wrap up our topic of changes to U.S. immigration laws since January 2021, when President Biden took office. One of the biggest changes that President Biden has done, which I'm very thankful for, was that he got rid of prior presidential proclamations from Donald Trump. Under Donald Trump, he made a couple of presidential proclamations, two of which I'm going to talk about here. For one, he stated that certain individuals or foreign nationals from these certain countries cannot obtain visas to enter the United States. And these countries just so happen to be Muslim-majority countries, meaning that there are a large percentage of Muslims in that country. And that's not right. You shouldn't discriminate against a person because of their religion. That's why we have the U.S. Constitution. Additionally, he made a presidential proclamation that limited the issuance of immigrant petitions or immigrant visas to qualified individuals. So this meant that if you did everything legally, you applied for a family petition and you submitted all the fees, you paid for your visa, you passed a criminal background check, you passed a medical check, and when you went in for your visa, the government stated that you're not going to be issued a visa because we're trying to protect, you know, U.S. jobs because of COVID-19. And this was really unfounded because these people did nothing wrong. The only thing that they did wrong was that they trusted the U.S. government in handling the COVID-19 pandemic. So instead of blaming foreign nationals for taking away government jobs, the U.S. government failed to acknowledge that it wasn't foreign nationals taking away jobs that caused jobs to, you know, worsening job numbers. It was an ineffective government handling the COVID-19 pandemic. So it's very good that President Biden reversed all those presidential proclamations. They made it harder for families to reunite. So the next major change to U.S. immigration laws involves changes with the Executive Office of Immigration Review. So if you happen to be in removal proceedings or deportation proceedings, you have to deal a lot with the immigration court under the guidance of the Executive Office of Immigration Review. Anytime that you file a pleading, a motion, or have to go to court, you usually have to file documents in person at the courthouse or mail it in. Now with the proposed changes, the government is going to revamp the government website and the EOIR portal, and they're going to eventually require that all filings be made electronically. For the people that are representing yourself, let's say, for example, you have no attorney, you can't afford an attorney, and you're doing this by yourself, it may be hard for you to do so because there's a lot of issues with online filings. Another thing to note is that these online filings have certain rules, like, you know, they have to be under 25 megabytes. They have to be a PDF or a JPEG. They have to be of a certain file size. They have to be labeled a certain way. So there's a lot of little, you know, things that you have to do when you do an online filing. And I think that when foreign nationals try to do this without an attorney, you're going to have a very hard time. But I will show you exactly what it looks like. I've actually went to their site recently. So here it is here. So if you log into the EOIR case portal, you can see, you know, I redacted some of the names for my client. You enter in your alien number, and then it'll pull up what type of case it is, when the notice to appear was given. If you filed anything else, it would be here. It would indicate when your next hearing date is, what court you're in. Usually it has the judge's name, and it also has the hearing location. So, and it also tells you if it's a master calendar hearing or an individual hearing. So this may seem really good because see how here it says you could upload documents, request a bond, download all these things, and file an appeal. You can do all of these things. However, I'm not really sure how well this is going to be implemented. I mean, it looks nice on its face. I'm very excited about this because it makes my job easier. No longer will I have to file something by mail or mail it off to immigration. It wastes a lot of paper. So going paperless has its advantages, but I'm just worried what's going to happen for people that cannot afford an attorney that are trying to do this themselves. The next two things that I will discuss, they're just proposals by President Biden, and these are not as yet law. So if you are waiting for these programs to happen, it may take years for it to happen. So the first one is DACA. So President Biden has stated that he wants people that have DACA, that have DACA for about 3 years, to be eligible for a green card. However, again, this is just a proposal and it could take years for this to be implemented. So if you have DACA and you qualify for something else, maybe you qualify for military parole in place, you qualify for a hardship waiver, maybe you should take those avenues and apply for government benefits that way, because who knows how long it would take you to get a green card if you waited around for this DACA or the DACA changes. The last major change to US immigration law so far involves President Biden's halt of the new Donald Trump rules with the H-1B program. So if you're at home and you're wondering what the H-1B program is, let me take a minute to just explain it to you. The H-1B program was designed to attract foreign nationals with advanced degrees to come to the US and temporarily share their knowledge and work with US companies. So it benefits the US because these employers will not have to outsource their work to foreign nationals, but instead hire those foreign nationals to live in the US. And when that happens, it's good because it benefits Americans as a whole. These foreign nationals have to rent, they have to buy houses in the US, they have to buy food, they have to buy clothes. And so it benefits the US as a whole because we're not outsourcing our work to a foreign country. So to obtain an H-1B visa, a foreign national first had to obtain a US 4-year bachelor's degree or its foreign equivalent. And if they had this, they would have to find a US employer that's willing to sponsor them to work in the US and promise to pay them a certain wage that's required by the US government. This way they're not mistreating the workers and paying them any less than the average US worker. So this program is very popular. And every year for the last couple of years, the H-1B cap has been reached, meaning that every year the government only allocates about 65 to 75,000 of these visas. And after they are reached, there is no more. And every year we are using all of these visas, which means that foreign US companies really like being able to hire these foreign nationals with advanced degrees. And remember what I just said. The foreign national needs to have at least a bachelor's degree. So a lot of times these foreign nationals would not only have a bachelor's degrees, they would have advanced degrees like master's degrees and doctorates that would help the US economy if they came to share their knowledge and expertise. And again, this is just a temporary work visa. So with Donald Trump, he may propose a new rule where instead of randomly selecting these visas, because what would happen is that in April 1st of every year, the government will start accepting new H-1B cases. And then out of those, let's say, for example, they receive 100,000 petitions. They would randomly select, 65,000 or 75,000 to be considered for an H-1B, visa. So under the Donald Trump administration, they proposed a new rule that was soon going to be enforced, where they were not going to focus on a random selection. They weren't just going to randomly select anyone. They were going to look at the amounts that the US employers were willing to pay these foreign nationals and allowing those individuals to come into the United States. And that's what they were going to focus on. So this was very controversial because it was going to help employers that were very big. So this was very controversial because what it seemed like the government was doing is that they were favoring the big companies and disfavoring the little companies. So if you're a big company, you can afford to pay more and well above the national average. And if you're a smaller company, you may need someone that's highly skilled to help you, but you can't afford to pay beyond what is the normal and average salary for a person in that position. So it's very controversial. So luckily, President Biden has put a halt to this change and this rule. And we'll see what happens because it's unknown whether or not it's going to be fully implemented or if it's actually going to be changed and revoked and put back to where it was before when the H-1B program first came into existence. So these are the major changes to US immigration laws since January 2021. So you can see there have been many changes to US laws just in the period of 3 months. If you want to stay abreast for future immigration changes, make sure you subscribe. That way you're always caught up and you know exactly what's going on with U.S. immigration laws. Again, thank you for watching Winning Law. I'm attorney David Wynn, and we hope that we have made immigration easier to understand.